Okay, so let's get started. Last class, we discussed about some basic features of pipelined processors. We had said that there are two basic kinds of pipeline: instruction pipeline and functional pipeline, right? And then we had said that instruction pipelines are being used in the commercial processor. Almost every processor uses instruction pipes. And we said that one thing that can really make a pipeline useless is the hazards. So today we'll look at the hazards, their causes, and the resolution mechanisms that are available. We'll see that over the years, more and more sophisticated techniques have come up, and the earlier prediction that was done in 1970s that instruction level parallelism is restricted to a speed up of about 2. We'll see that that limit has been broken long back, and we have still more and more advanced techniques that have become available, which are being used in the modern processors. So in this series of next few lectures, we'll first look at hazards, their causes, and how they can be resolved. We'll look at branch prediction, and then we'll look at loop level parallelism. What is loop level parallelism, how it can be exploited, and then we'll look at a very important technique, the dynamic instruction scheduling, which is a hardware technique to resolve hazards. Under the dynamic instruction scheduling, we'll look at the original scoreboarding approach, and we'll see its improvisation, which was quite a bit of change in the Tomasello's algorithm. We'll look at compiler techniques for exposing instruction level parallelism, look at superscalar and VLIW processing, and then we'll survey some of the modern processors that are being available nowadays. So first, let's recapture what we're doing. We had defined what is instruction level parallelism. We had said that if there are independent threads, then for each thread, we are considering our attention to one thread. So the instructions that are present on a single thread, if they can be executed in parallel, right? We are not considering different threads. We are considering the same thread. Instructions belonging to the same thread are being executed concurrently or in an overlapped fashion. Then we have instruction level parallelism. And as we are discussing that a thread consists of basic blocks, and also in the threads there will be branches, loops, and so on. But what exactly is a basic block? Can somebody say what is a basic block? Yes. Okay. A sequence of instructions which are either executed in their entirety or not. So a basic block is a sequence of instructions not having a branch instruction. So either they are executed in entirety or they are not executed at all. So the instruction pipelines, as we have been discussing in the last class, they can effectively exploit parallelism present in a basic block. We'll see that the branch statements and so on, they cause little bit of problem. We'll see how to overcome them. But as far as a single basic block is concerned, the pipelines as it is, they can exploit parallelism from the sequence of instructions which will be just flowing one after the other, excepting that there might be some hazards, right? And then we had seen that under this condition, that the program consists of a single basic block and a large program, an n stage pipeline can improve performance up to n times. We had seen that last time, and we had seen that the big advantage of pipeline is that it does not require any large investment in hardware, just the same hardware, little bit of reorganization and so on, it would give us the performance improvement. And another, possibly the biggest advantage, it's transparent to programmers. same program, it is running on a uniprocessor, it will run but at a faster pace. So we will further elaborate the next point, which says that the pipeline can be viewed to decrease the average CPI. We had seen this so far, that the cycles per instructions, average cycle per instruction is reduced through a pipelined execution. If it used to take 5 cycles per instruction, average 5 cycles per instruction, after pipelining it might take 1, right? But the other view, we can also have decrease in clock cycle time per instructions. We had not discussed this view so far, because due to pipelining we can simplify the hardware and we can also decrease the clock cycle time, right? Because now after pipelining we have smaller stages, right? Each stage does little bit of work, we can simplify that and we can reduce the cycle time.
What is the difference between the
two? Okay, see, so far we had discussed in our last lecture that the effect of a pipeline would be to decrease the average CPI, and then we had said that the cycle time remains constant. But what I am saying right now is that the cycle time also may change, because pipelining may simplify the hardware and we can use a faster clock, right? So, or another thing that we should also remember is that sometimes it may be preferable to think that pipelining has resulted in a decreased clock cycle time, and the CPI, average CPI, is remaining constant, only you have reduced the clock cycle time. That is another view. So it might so happen that we have both decreased the average CPI and also both decreased the clock cycle time. Is that okay? See, decreased clocks, average CPI results in performance improvement, which we had calculated, and that time we had assumed that clock cycle time remains constant. But what I am saying is that sometimes we might even have a reduced clock cycle time. It is one aspect. The other aspect I am saying is that sometimes, to simplify our discussion, we can say that, see, the average CPI is remaining constant, only the clock cycle time is reducing. Yeah, right.
Then decrease clock cycle time for instruction, it is not for instructions.
Yeah, definitely. See, if the over the stages, each stage is using a faster clock cycle, so earlier whatever time was required, sorry?
For a sequence of instructions.
No, for one instruction, we can have a reduced number of clock cycles, right? So we will use a clock cycle or a pipeline cycle which is faster than the unpipelined processor. It's possible. Right. But as we are discussing that, unless we address some problems, all the advantages of pipeline will be negated. Now let us see what are the factors that can drag down the performance of a pipeline. The factors that can drag down the performance of a pipeline are unbalanced stages. We had said that it is very difficult to balance the different stages of a pipeline. Any hardware designer will tell, it's really, really difficult. And as a result, you will see that different manufacturers, they organize their instructions into different number of stages, each doing very different type of work, as we will see subsequently, but still they are not really balanced. So unbalancing is a problem. And then we have the pipeline overheads. We had talked about the setup time or the pipeline registers and so on. We discussed about clock skew, but the biggest thing out of all these is the hazards, is the biggest drag on the performance of the pipeline, as we will see shortly. We have so far not discussed much about hazards. The hazards cause the worst drag on the performance of a pipeline. Now let us look at what is a hazard. A hazard is a situation that prevents an instruction from executing in its designated clock cycles. So each instruction, as it flows through the pipeline, it's supposed to take certain clock cycles and complete. But we'll see that sometimes we'll be forced to stop an instruction, and as a result it will execute in cycles other than that was required. There are three classes of hazards. This is a question normally we ask during your vivas and so on, that what is a hazard, what are the different classes of hazard, give examples of each and so on. So important topic, hazard is a very important topic in any pipeline discussion, because as we are saying that unless we understand hazards and see how to tackle them, the pipeline will be useless. So there are three classes of hazards: structural hazards, data hazards and control hazards. Now let's look at each of them. The structural hazards, they arise from resource conflicts among instructions that are executing concurrently. Each instruction as it executes requires certain resource, right? The same resource may be required by two or more concurrently executing. Okay, we should actually write here, instead of concurrently, overlap execution. That might be more appropriate, because these instructions are not really fully concurrent, they are overlapped. So the same resource is required during the execution of overlapped executing instructions at the same time. We will just see some examples of where, what kind of resources might be required by these overlapped executing instructions. Since this is the hardware which causes the problem, there are more instructions needing the hardware, and at a time only one can be served by the hardware. We can avoid these kind of hazards by duplicating the resources, but we will see that sometimes we can't really duplicate the resources. So these are some of the examples of hazards and their resolution. One is that, see, there is a arithmetic unit, right, where the ALU operations are performed. But also remember that after the instruction fetch, the PC has to be incremented, right? For MIPS, the instructions are 4 bytes long, right? So the PC has to be incremented by 4. But how does that do that? ALU would be used by another instruction which is doing the arithmetic operation. So we have to provide a special order to the instruction fetch unit, which will increment the PC by 4, right? So by duplicating hardware, see, we need not have a sophisticated ALU for incrementing PC, just a order possibly, right? But we have to provide that, otherwise there will be a structural hazard. Similarly, separate data cache and instruction cache is required, because some instruction might be fetched, and for another instruction the data has to be either written or loaded from the cache. So this is an example of a structural hazard. So one instruction here, it is doing its data operation during the memory stage. This is a MIPS pipeline. During the memory stage, load store operation is being performed on the data, okay, on the cache, and here an instruction is being fetched from the cache. So if it is just one unified cache which can supply only one unit per clock cycle, then we have to stall one of these. But as we will see that all processors, pipeline processors, will have two separate caches, instruction cache and data cache. Otherwise this problem, this hazard will occur every time a data is being, instruction is fetched and another instruction is going to write into the memory. Now let's look at the data hazards. We looked at the structural hazards. Now let's look at the data hazards. The data hazards occur when an instruction under execution depends on the data from another instruction that is ahead in the pipeline. So just see here an example, that we have the instruction A is equal to B plus C is an instruction where A is being defined, A is getting a new value, whereas A is being used in the second instruction, D is equal to A plus E. So if we try to visualize in the pipeline, A is equal to B plus C, the A would be produced only during the write back stage where the register is updated. Just remember the MIPS pipeline, there the register updation occurs in the write back stage, whereas the operand A would be required in the ID stage, right. So, if it tries to read the operand A, then it will get a old value, and as a result either we do something or we get an incorrect result. So, this is an example of a data hazard. So, if we unless we do something, the dependent instruction would use the old data and would result in wrong computation. The third type of hazard is the control hazard. This results from branch and other instructions that change the flow of a program. For example, we have, let us say, just consider the simple code. Depending on some condition, S1 is executed, otherwise S2 is executed, right. So, S1 is dependent on this condition. The condition becomes true, S1 will be executed. So, while executing this instruction, if we also simultaneously start executing S1, then we will have to flush the pipeline, because S1 may not be required, it might be S2. So, the statement in the line 2, that is S1, is control dependent on the statement at line 1. This is the vocabulary which compiler writers use. We will also use the same vocabulary, that S1 is control dependent on the statement at line 1, and until the condition is evaluated, we will not know which would execute next, S1 or S2. Now, just to elaborate our point, now let us examine this code. If condition S1, if condition 1 S1, if condition 2 S2, and that is this loop, a nested loop basically. So, can you identify the control dependencies? What about S1?
Condition 1.
So, this is in statement 1, but what about S2? Yeah, it is dependent on both this. On 3 and 1, there is a dependency from here to here, and also a dependency from here to here, right. But to have another view on hazards, we have to think that there are something in the programs which cause the hazards, and these are the dependencies that execute in the, that are present in the program. The hazards can be caused by dependence within a program. See, mark the word can be caused, because we have written here can be caused because sometimes there might exist dependencies, but they may not result in any hazard. We will just have a look. If you look at a program, as do most compiler writers do, they identify three main types of dependencies in a program. One is the data dependence, another is name dependence, the other is a control dependence. Let us look at these dependencies. The data dependence, an instruction J is said to be data dependent on another instruction I if either there is a direct dependency or a transitive one. The direct one, let us look at it, that a register R1 and R2 are used as operands and produce the result in R3. Now, the register R3 is used as a operand and it produces result in R5. So, just see that there is a dependency from instruction 1 to instruction 2. Okay. So, the dependency is from R3 to R3 is produced and R3 is used. Okay, possibly this arrow should have come here, that would have been more meaningful, is not it? Right. So, R3 is produced and R3 is used here, there is a dependency from instruction 2 to instruction 1. There can be a transitive data dependency. R3 is produced in the first instruction, which is used in the second instruction, which produces R4. R4 is used in the third instruction. So, there is a transitive dependency from instruction 3 to instruction 1. There is a direct dependency from instruction 2 to instruction 3 to instruction 2, right? But suppose there are dependencies in a program, but how do you detect them? One obvious thing that we saw in the previous slide is to look at the register names. So, but just remember that the data value between instructions may either flow through registers, as we looked at the example, but they might also flow through memory locations. One instruction updates a memory location, and another instruction requires that as an operand, right? When the data flow is through a register, detection is straightforward. You just look at the register names and so on. But when the data flow is through a memory location, a simple compiler technique would be very difficult to use. The reason is that even if they refer to the same memory location, it might appear very different. For example, 100 R4 and 20 R6, they might actually be referring to the same memory location. But how do you detect them using compiler techniques? So, we will see that when the data flow is through a memory location, we do not have a software solution. We will have to use a hardware solution. We will have a look at that. But let us just remember right now that data flow might occur either through registers or through memory locations. And when the dependency is through due to a register flow, then it is straightforward, can be done through a compiler. Whereas, if it is through a memory location, compiler techniques are insufficient, and we would modern processors use hardware to do this. Now, let us look at the data dependencies. So far, we just looked at data dependencies as some data that is flowing and so on, right? But now, let us try to see in more detail. We will see that there are basically two types of data dependencies. One is the true data dependence and the other is called as a name dependence. In the true data dependence, there is actually a data value that gets defined and being used in another instruction, whereas in the other, they are using the same name or the same register or memory location, but there is no real value that is flowing between them. There is no true flow of data between the two instructions. Just to give an example here, that A is equal to B plus C and A is equal to P plus Q. A is used by both of them, but they do not, the A produced here is not used here. So, this is called as a name dependence. Possibly, if A was a different name, we had used a different name here, instead of A is equal to B plus C, if I had written D is equal to B plus C, if I had given a different name to A or a different memory location, then this problem could not have arisen. And that tells us that a solution to a name dependence would be simple.
Is it really dependent?
Yeah, this is a dependence. This will create a problem. This will create a data hazard, right? We'll see how it will create. We'll just look at a picture and see that they really create a problem. Because, see, during pipeline, if finally the value of A should be due to this one, right? The final value of A should be due to the second instruction. Then we'll say that the program works correctly. But during pipelined execution, it might so happen that the first A completes later. We'll see examples, and then we'll have a problem. We'll see examples of that. So, as we are saying that the name dependencies are due to using the same name or a register or a memory location. And as a result, the resolution of this will be also simple. We can just rename. We will see that, how do we rename and things like that. But again, If we think of name dependences, if we examine that still closer, we will see that there are two types of name dependences. One is called as anti-dependence and the other is output dependence. Let us see exactly what is anti-dependence and what is output dependence. An anti-dependence between two instructions occurs if then I and J are two instructions, I precedes J. If J writes to a register or a memory location that I reads, right? See, J is the second instruction, I is the first instruction. So, J is writing to a register and I is reading from that register. There is no flow of data here, isn't it? Because I has first read and then J is writing to the register. There is no flow of data. I doesn't require the value produced by J. But the thing is that they are using the same register, and if there is an interchange, the order in which it is reading and writing, then we will have problem. Just to give an example, so the original ordering of I and J, we must ensure that they are preserved, otherwise we will have an incorrect result. Just to give an example, this is a MIPS code. Add two floating point registers F6, F8 and produce the result in F0. And subtract, it is subtracting F5 contents of F5 from the contents of F4 and producing the result in F8. So, ARD is not really requiring this F8, right, the result in this F8, but the old F8 it was requiring. But due to some reason, as we will see, if this first produces the result in F8, then that will result in a ARD getting a wrong value of F8, right? It will create a problem. So, that is the anti-dependence. Now, let us look at the output dependence. So, anti and output dependence, both are name dependencies. There is no true flow of data. In output dependence, if there are two instructions I and J such that both write to the same memory location or register, write to the same memory location or register. Here, ordering of the instructions must be preserved, because if J produces the data first, then it will be overwritten by I and will have an undesired value as a result. We must ensure that the finally written value corresponds to J. Now, before we proceed further, let us try to identify all dependencies that exist in the following C code. So, A is equal to B plus C, that is first statement. Second statement, B is equal to C plus D. Third statement, A is equal to A plus C, and C is equal to B plus A. Can you identify all the data dependencies that exist in this code? What about between 1 and 2? Are there any dependencies? Yeah. Yeah, see, B is defined here, B is used here. So, there is an anti-dependency between 1 and 2, right? What about between 3 and either 2 or 1? Is there any dependency? What kind of dependency? 1 and 3, what kind of dependency? There is output dependency between 1 and 3. But what about this C? Does it cause any problem? No. See, both are just reading C, there is no problem here. But what about 4 and either 1, 2, 3? Is there any dependency? Okay. There is an anti-dependency between 3 and 4, 2 and 3, sorry, 2 and 4. Isn't it? And 1 and 4. And there is a data dependency from 1 to 3 and 3 to 4. 1, 3 and 3, 4. So, we saw that the dependencies cause hazards. The dependencies can cause hazards. Now, let us look at hazard resolution with whatever knowledge we have so far. The name dependencies, as you are saying, that once identify, we can easily eliminate. Just what is the word eliminate? because the code that the processor does, it doesn't have to do anything. If we can eliminate the hazard by renaming, the pipeline gets a good code, doesn't have to do anything. So if we have a simple compiler renaming technique to identify this kind of name dependencies and eliminate that, then the pipeline would not have to do anything. But again, we told that in that is very simple, but still there is an intricacy. What about memory related dependencies? Because name dependencies can also arise due to memory, right? Memory locations. So this would be difficult to identify through a compiler, and we would have to use hardware techniques. We'll subsequently discuss about the scoreboarding, dynamic instruction scheduling, and so on, which are being used. Scoreboarding is no more used. It was the precursor to dynamic instruction scheduling. But dynamic instruction scheduling is being used in almost every processor that you see nowadays. But the true data dependencies, they are more difficult to handle than the name dependencies. We cannot really eliminate a true data dependency by any compiler techniques and so on. We can only overcome, we can reduce the effect of a true data dependency. We'll see how. We'll require that pipeline stall to be minimal, or the number of instructions coming out of the pipeline to remain as constant as possible, right? So we will see how we can really overcome the difficulties caused by true data dependencies. But we can't really eliminate true data dependencies. We'll see that here a lot of advancement have occurred over the years. So we have seen that data hazards are caused by data dependencies. Various types of data dependency we saw: true dependency, name dependency, again anti-dependency, output dependency, right? But the thing that we should remember is that even if there is a data dependency, sometimes they may not result in a data hazard. Can you tell why? Yes. Okay. Yeah. See, he gives an example that an instruction 1 produces a data that is used by another instruction 5. So there is a dependency, data dependency, but that don't cause a problem. Right? They are separated. That's what he says. So you can think of many reasons, many examples where even if there is a dependence, it will not really result in a hazard. Now, if we examine the hazards in little more detail, the data hazards, we will see that there are three types: read after write, write after write, and write after read. And one thing to note here is that with in-order execution machines, an in-order execution machine is one where until the preceding instruction completes, the next instruction does not complete. So the instructions complete in sequence. That is an in-order execution machine. But we will see that most of the processors nowadays are out of order. That is, even if one instruction precedes another instruction, but the one that was succeeding might complete earlier than the preceding instruction. So only in those kind of machines, the write after write and write after read hazards will occur. If it is an in-order machine, then write after write will not occur, because in any way, the first instruction would have completed, then the second instruction will write. See, the first instruction writes, then the second instruction writes. So there is no hazard, isn't it? Write after write hazard will not occur.
Sir, for in-order execution, the pipeline efficiency will be decreased.
Sorry, can you please?
In-order execution, the pipeline efficiency will be decreased.
No. See, the thing is that so far what we have been discussing is in-order execution. We are saying that instructions, once they are set up, right, the program order, they complete. So we have so far not discussed anything about out-of-order execution. But we will see that the in-order execution, we would not be able to really overcome data hazards. In an in-order execution, we will not be really be able to overcome efficiently the data hazards and many other types of hazards. As a result, the pipeline would not really give a good speed up. So, if we make it out of order execution, whichever instruction is ready to execute, it does not depend on data from a previous instruction, we can start executing that.
Sir?
Right, yes, please.
In order means the first instruction will be executed first and after
exactly.
The initial.
No. We are not saying that they after the first completes, the second will start. We are saying that they complete in the same order in which they are there in the program. We are talking of the completion order. We are not saying that they are executing sequentially. We are saying that they are executing concurrently, but they are completing in the same order as per their program order. That is the only thing that we are saying. But we are saying that in an in-order execution, the write after write and write after read hazards will not occur because the in-order completion guarantees that the first write will occur and then only the second write will occur. See, this hazard arises if the first instruction writes after the second instruction or the second instruction completes before the first instruction. But we are saying that in an in-order execution that will not occur. They will complete in their order, control order in the program, right?
First instruction is not finished. At that time, second instruction never will be executed or finished first.
Yeah, we'll see that. Unless the first instruction completes, the second instruction will not get the pipeline stage that is required by the first instruction. It cannot complete. Whereas we'll see that in the out of order execution, we can even complete instruction that is much later in the program order. We'll see the details of this with examples. So let's consider two instruction where I precedes J. I is the first instruction, J is the second instruction. So first let's look at the read after write hazard. So I is writing R1, isn't it? I is writing to R1 and J is reading R1. So, there is a true data dependency from I to J. Do you agree with this? There is a true data dependency from I to J. It is defining a value that is reading this one. So, this is a read after write hazard. The instruction J tries to read its operand, and if instruction I has not produced the operand by that time, there will be a wrong result. So, instruction J is following instruction I. I is the first instruction, J is the second instruction, right. So, we can have a hazard here. We can have many more examples of the read after write dependency. For example, here instruction 1, we are loading R1 with some address. And in the second instruction, we are using R1, right? In the other example, we are producing R1 in a register and then using that in instruction 2. So, these two are compiler writers use different names for them. The first dependency is called as a load use dependency, right? We are loading the value R1 and then using it. The second one is a define use dependency, but both of them are basically true data dependencies and they can result in a RAW hazard. A raw hazard can be caused by either a load use dependency or a define use dependency.
Sir, why write after read cannot occur in in-order?
Sorry, can you please?
Why WK dependency can occur in?
See, the instruction I1 will first, we have examples coming up actually, but the first program the first instruction could first read its data, then it would write. It cannot occur that for the second instruction writes and the first one reads. We will not have that situation, because the second instruction will complete only after the first instruction completes, isn't it? So, write after read hazard will not occur. Are you convinced? We will have examples coming up, of course, but are you convinced now that write after read hazard will not occur in an in order pipeline? Because the writing of the second instruction cannot complete until the first instruction completes all its reading, writing, etc. Isn't it? So, let us look at the write after write. So, here instruction J is writing to F1, instruction I is writing to F1. So, there is a chance of write after write hazard, but as we said that in an in order pipeline, this cannot occur. This is an example of an out of order pipeline. We will get more and more acquainted with this kind of a pipeline. See here, there is a instruction fetch, instruction decode, there is a read operand and so on, but after that, depending on whether it is an integer operation, addition, ALU operation, or it is a floating point operation, or it is a load store operation, they go through different units, right? And some of them, as we have been discussing about the MIPS pipeline, we said that see, some stages during execution they can take more time, they might loop, isn't it? So, this might loop 2 times here, this might loop 3 times here and so on. So, they might produce result in different order, isn't it? Because some might get delayed here passing through these 3, another comes out quickly, right? So, this might result in an out of order execution. We will see more details of it, the different problems that might occur in out of order pipeline, imprecise exceptions and so on. But that we will discuss little later. But right now, just to have a general idea about what a out of order pipeline might look like, this is an example. Now, let us look at the write after read hazard. So, here as we are saying that instruction J is producing F1 and instruction I is reading F1, but since we are guaranteeing that in an in order pipeline that I will complete first, including its reading etc. must be over before J produces its result. So, this kind of hazard cannot occur in an in order pipeline. So, if you think of this, that the write after read hazard is caused by anti-dependence, isn't it? If you look at the example that we heard earlier, if you think of it, there is anti-dependence here, and the anti-dependence causes a write after read hazard. It is a type of name dependency, because this results from reuse of the name F1. If it was a different name, if the instruction 2 had produced its result in some other register like F6 or something, then this might not have occurred. And it does not happen in a MIPS 5-stage pipeline, as we will see, because all instructions take 5 stages, right? We are not looking at the floating point looping and so on. We are just thinking of a simple 5-stage pipeline. All instructions take 5 cycles and 5 stages actually. Let me not say cycle, because some might complete later. The reads are always in stage 2 and the writes are always in stage 5. Okay. Now, these are some more examples of the write after read and write after write. So, here basically R2 is being defined here, being used here, and here R1 is defined and R1 is, sorry, both are defined here, right? So, what kind of dependency is this? Write after read, right? And what about this? Write after write. But what about this code? See, instruction 1 has operands R2, R3, produces result in R1, and the second one adds R4, R5, produces result in R2. What is the kind of hazard here? What is the dependence and what is the hazard? There is a anti-dependence here, isn't it? that is a right after read hazard occurring here, isn't it? So please get familiar with this kind of examples, because they are crucial to understanding the hazard resolution techniques. Very simple things. So if we think of, then there is a true data dependence would result, might result in a read after write hazard, and then the name dependencies, these are also called as false dependency, right? The other one is a true dependency, this is a false dependency, because they can be eliminated. There is no true data flow occurring right after read, as we had seen, and right after write hazards, and then we have the control dependence. Now let's proceed further. Okay, there is a summary of the data dependencies. So the data dependencies can either result in read after write hazard. This is due to the true flow dependency or true data dependencies. There can be two types, the load use dependency and define use dependency, which constitute the true dependency, cannot be really eliminated. This is not a correct word here, overcome. They can be overcome, as do most processors do, but they cannot be eliminated. Whereas the other ones are false dependencies, write after read and write after write, caused due to anti-dependence and output dependence. These are false dependency and can be eliminated by renaming techniques. So this is a summary also, that the dependencies can be data dependency and control dependency, which exist in a program. The true data dependency can result in a read after write hazard. The output, the name dependency is two types, output and anti-dependence. Output dependence can result in a write after write hazard. Anti-dependence can result in a write after read hazard. And the control dependency can result in a control hazard. And there can be a structural hazard. We can't really identify them from the program. But let's look at the solutions. As we were saying, that the name dependencies, they are the easiest to tackle. So let's look at that. Rename registers, right? Instead of having, let's say, an R1 here, we'll just rename it as R6 or something. We'll get rid of the dependency. Instead of producing the result in R1, we'll rename it as R6. Register renaming can get rid of most false dependencies, and compilers can do the renaming in the register allocation process. Now let's look little bit about how the compiler techniques can tackle data hazards. The compiler can help eliminate some data hazards. An instruction that uses result of a load's destination register should not immediately follow the load instruction. So if it can shift them, like you were saying, that the result, see, load destination register, and if you can separate the use of that load operand, sorry, the operand that was loaded, if you can insert some other instructions in between, right, then we can eliminate this kind of hazard also by the compiler. So we'll see some of the examples like this, which the compiler can help. These are called as compiler based pipeline instruction scheduling. See, here we just change the instruction order without really affecting the result. The compilers could find that, see, the load was, can be done before, much before it is used. It is possible sometimes, and then we can eliminate this kind of problem. So this will be called as the compiler based pipeline instruction scheduling. We'll have a look at them in more detail. We can use hardware techniques to deal with hazards. The simplest used long back is to stall the pipeline. And as we are saying, that the modern technique is, don't stall the pipeline, that will drag the performance. As far as possible, don't do a interlocking. Pipelines without interlocks and so on, right? So stalling is a very old technique, should not be used. So when pipelines stall, some instructions in a pipeline proceed and the others are made to wait, right, the complete letter. That's the simple stall techniques, old technique, rarely used nowadays. So this is the example. Just see here that this instruction, a load instruction, it is loading some data into this some register, right? Whereas another instruction is trying to fetch, doing a memory operation. This is doing on a data memory operation, this is an instruction memory. But if there is a single cache, we will have a hazard, isn't it? Are you able to notice the hazard here? Right? So one solution would be to stall it, or if we find that there is a data memory access coming and there is also instruction to be fetched, we will stop the instruction fetch. We will put a no up here or a bubble here. We will fetch the instruction in the next time, right? Because these two do not use the data memory, that time we can fetch the instruction, right? So by stalling the pipeline, we could overcome this kind of hazard. So we today running short of time, we will just stop here, continue from this point tomorrow.